There's a big move to promote Meatless Mondays these days. Now, eating vegetarian is not only good for your health, it's also good for your wallet, and it's fantastic for the planet. There's no one better to explore vegetarian options than Amanda Cohen. She's the chef and owner of Dirt Candy, a vegetarian restaurant in New York City. She's so creative. With me, she's making zucchini and pasta noodles and garlicky yogurt sauce. And this sounds like so much fun. Kentucky lemonade spiked with, you guessed it, bourbon. I'll also make Shu vegetables, a hearty combination of crunchy vegetables in thin pancakes with cashews and eggs. Welcome to Sara's Weeknight Meals. Today, we're going meatless.
Funding provided by...
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester, with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
And thanks to the generous support of... After I ate at Dirt Candy, Amanda Cohen's restaurant, I decided she was one of the most inventive chefs I've ever come across. So we're going to spend a little time with her and find out how she does what she does.
My name is Amanda Cohen, and I am the chef owner of Dirt Candy. It is an all-vegetable restaurant in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. I named my restaurant Dirt Candy because that's really what vegetables are to me. They are candy from the dirt. They are earth candy. And I did it because I knew it would really offend people. And they'd be like, why do you have dirt in the name of your restaurant? But they would never forget it. Once you've heard Dirt Candy, you can't unhear it. We really focus on vegetables, whereas vegetarian restaurants focus a little bit more on the lifestyle of being a vegetarian. It's not about being healthy for me. I'm actually not a vegetarian, but I was a vegetarian. I became one when I was 15 years old. All my friends were becoming vegetarians, so I decided, yeah, I'll be one too. And it's gonna piss my parents off, so it's a win-win situation. And then one day, about 10 years ago, I realized to become a better chef, I had to really start tasting what other chefs cared about. And what other chefs cared about was proteins on the plate. And so I realized there is really a market here. There is something I can do. Nobody cares about the vegetables. Let me care about the vegetables. The way I look at it, it's sort of like the Wild West of the food world. There are no rules. We get to come into this restaurant every day and treat it like our lab. It's like we're little kids playing, and it's fun. Nobody else is doing this, so for us, it's like a whole open field of ideas.
At Dirt Candy, the flavors are bold. The food is smoked, cured, condensed, spiced, and the textures are deliberately surprising.
So what we do on a plate is we roast carrots, we dehydrate them, we puree them, maybe we deep fry them, and all of a sudden you have all these different textures that have elevated that carrot from a unitextured vegetable into something amazing.
Dirt Candy amazed the food world. Awards followed, then a cookbook, and like the restaurant, it is totally unique. A comic book with artist Ryan Dunleavy.
You know, since you're training the people, like when they read the book, you can do it, we could do something really silly, like make it like a kung fu training.
Like a kung fu master?
Yeah, yeah. We'll have people that don't look normal. Like you guys.
Yeah, we don't look normal, do we?
No.
It's one of the few times in life where you have a vision in your head and it actually is able to come true. The only thing that didn't quite come true was the sketches of me. And I was like, these are really cute, but I thought I'd look more like Wonder Woman. And he was like, no, I'm not drawing you like that. And I was like, fine. Like, I want boots and the, you know, corset. Like, ugh.
Of course, there are recipes, but also the dark side of restaurant ownership few see.
I definitely think chefs are way over glamorized. And once you become the owner of a restaurant, you are everything to everybody 24 hours a day. Kyle, I have a pickles. That one's going to 411. It's too much sauce. This is going to 405. We don't say no. These are called gold moths.
I have a ticket in.
Accidents do happen. Just put it in the back room and they'll deal with it. I'd like to start selling this one. Feel free to eat it like you would a regular hot dog with your hands, not with a fork and knife, unless you are the Queen of England. It's hours and hours of hard work. It's 70-hour weeks, 80-hour a week of hard work. You're cutting yourself, you're burning yourself. It's hot in the kitchen. But at the end of the day, why wouldn't you want to do it? The satisfaction in this job lies for me at the end of the night when we've had guests come up to us all night and saying they've had an amazing time, and not just that they had a great meal and the food was delicious, but that the service was great and the drinks were great, and just that the whole picture was exactly what they wanted it to be at that moment. And I think, wow, we did a good job today.
You know what, Doug, can I have some arugula?
Arugula?
Yes.
There you are.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
This next recipe is my version of the Chinese restaurant favorite, mushu pork, only I removed the pork because there's so many vegetables in that dish. It's that vegetable mixture with pork that's served in pancakes, and that's what I'm really excited about is the pancakes. But these aren't just any pancakes. I'm making the French crepes, those really thin, thin pancakes that I think makes everybody nervous. There's no need to be nervous. I'm going to show you how easy they are to make. We're going to start by making the batter. Let me get my butter out of the microwave here. So I have 5 tablespoons of butter here. 3 of them are going to go into the batter, and 2 of them I'm going to save to brush the pan. Okay, 1 cup of whole milk. And then we're going to use some regular all-purpose flour. Unbleached all-purpose flour, 1/2 cup. And measure it the appropriate way, which is to not pack it. You just sort of loosely put it into the measuring cup. A little bit of salt. We're using table salt because it's finer. If you had fine sea salt, that would be great too. 2 eggs, and basically that's it. It's just a very, very simple recipe. When you make a batter like this that has flour and liquids in it, you have to be careful not to overbeat it, because if you do, what you're going to do is develop the gluten in the flour. That's the protein that's in the flour. And gluten's very useful when you're making bread because you want all that structure, but not when you're making something tender like crepes. So I'm just going to beat this briefly. And we're going to put it through a strainer to remove any lumps that didn't get mixed in just then. And then we're going to let this batter sit for about 1/2 hour. And what happens in that 1/2 hour is the little bit of gluten that we did just develop by hitting that button will relax, because we want tender crepes. So now we're going to get into production. Now this is the part that seems to scare people, although I don't think it should. I've got a wonderful pan here. You can use a nonstick, or this is a stick resistant, which I prefer. Oh, I can see that it's very hot, maybe a little too hot. So usually the first pancake doesn't work and you don't worry about it. My favorite spatula, because it's deep, in order to get in there is this fish spatula that's flexible. Okay, let me see how this is doing. You just take a little sneak peek. There we go. And boom! Now, isn't that easy? I think one of the other reasons people don't make crepes, or they're scared to, is they think that you can't stack them without putting a piece of parchment between each crepe. But you don't have to worry about it. You can stack them, and I'm going to show you. I'm even going to put this one that's hot on top. There you go. And I guarantee you, it's not going to stick. So I'm going to make a little omelet, a very thin omelet. It's part of the filling for our mushu crepes. We basically do it the same way we just did the crepes. And we used a flavorless vegetable oil because this is an Asian dish. When I'm doing Asian recipes, I generally use grapeseed oil. When I'm doing Mediterranean dishes, I generally use olive oil. There we go. Now I'm going to prep all my veggies.
I've already grated a 3-inch piece of ginger in here, and to that I'm gonna add 3 garlic cloves. I'm just gonna grate through a microplane right into the ginger. So I'm just gonna chop 4 scallions. I've got about 8 ounces of shiitake mushrooms here. Okay, so we've got our shiitakes. We've got 1 large red bell pepper that we julienned. And now I'm gonna slice my bok choy. I got about 1/2 pound. Okay. I have everything ready. This is one of those Asian recipes where everything has to be ready. Grapeseed oil, because we don't really care about the flavor. We just want it to do its oil thing. In's gonna go our ginger, our garlic, and our scallions for a quick saute. I'm gonna add a tiny pinch of salt. Next, the mushrooms and the red bell pepper. I love shiitake mushrooms because they have such body. They're not as, somehow they don't give off all the liquid that other mushrooms do. Told you there were a lot of vegetables in here. And while that's cooking for a minute, I'm gonna mix up my sauce, which is very, very simple. I need 2 tablespoons of sake, 1 tablespoon of soy sauce, you can use low sodium, and 1 tablespoon of hoisin. If you've ever been to one of those Chinese restaurants and had Peking duck, they give this to you to spread on the pancake. All right, now we're gonna add, you can see this is wilted down. We want everything to have a little bit of a crunch. I'm gonna add my bok choy. All right, this is gonna take a minute to wilt down. I'm just gonna keep an eye on it and stir. All right, after it's started to wilt, I'm gonna add our sprouts. This is a final nice crunch. If you can't find them, don't worry about it. Amazing how much all of that wilts down. Okay, we're gonna finish up here with our egg. Just cut it into whatever pieces, whatever size you want. And I've got some toasted cashews. It's nice to add nuts, and cashews go perfectly in here. And then last but not least, our sauce. Remember the sake, soy sauce, and hoisin. And this will sort of deglaze the bottom of the pan because these vegetables give off a little bit of their own sugar and create those brown bits. And that is it. And oh boy, I wish you could smell it. So you can either warm the crepes in the oven first, or because the filling's so hot, I'm not gonna worry about it. We're gonna serve this family style, which is a really fun way to do it. So we put all the filling into a bowl, and then we put all of our pancakes onto a plate. So you put your crepe down. I'm gonna put a little bit of the hoisin first. You spread it down. And then we mound some of the filling right in the middle. It's like a burrito. Only it's far more elegant. So you start rolling it up, and then you can fold in the sides, and that way you don't wear it when you first pick it up. And then it is ready to just take a bite out of. Isn't that fun? What an exotic and unusual meal on a weeknight. And you know what? Don't tell anybody there's no meat in it. They won't be sorry.
How was the train ride?
It was easy.
Yeah, it is easy. I love trains, don't you? Yeah, it's just so calm and so wonderful. So when it's your night off, do you cook?
I don't cook that much. I try to go out to eat and see what other chefs are cooking.
Oh, that's a good idea. I can see that. But if you had to cook
it all. If I had to cook, I like to do really simple things, so there are not too many dishes to do at the end of the night.
Oh,
so maybe like just a simple salad or some pasta.
Yeah.
so happy to have you here. And I love your book.
Thank you.
Fun book. It's more like a comic book than a cookbook.
It is.
So I'm so excited. We're making a wonderful vegetarian meal, but we're making a drink first. What are we making?
We are making my Kentucky lemonade. So we're going to roast lemons, add some beets into it, and have this delicious Kentucky bourbon lemonade.
So we need vanilla bean.
One vanilla bean.
Do you know about this trick? I just learned this trick. You know how you buy a vanilla bean and it's all dry and crackly?
Yep.
Well, if you put a little bourbon, we like that.
I like the bourbon.
I like the bourbon. And the bottom of the glass, and then you just turn it around every so often in the cupboard, it stays nice and pliable.
I love it.
Yeah. And then you get to, as you said, get to drink the bourbon.
I want to drink the bourbon.
Yeah. Oh, vanilla bourbon, why not? You need me to get you...
I need some sugar and water.
Okay, so let me get you, the water is here. How did you come up with this idea?
Well,
to roast lemons,
we wanted to bring out a little bit more of the citrus flavor and the sweetness in the lemons. So we figured that roasting would start to caramelize it a little.
Oh, that's so great. You know what I'm confused about, though? So I just dump this on top?
Just dump it in.
Okay. Is how do the lemons get caramelized when there's water in there?
We're just going to caramelize the top, and it's just like roasting a vegetable. It works.
And just one lone vanilla bean, huh?
One lone vanilla bean. You don't want it to be too vanilla-y. It's not a sweet drink.
Yeah. So I'm going to open this up, and we're going to do this together. Okay.
Oops.
All right. Great.
It takes about 45 minutes at 375 degrees.
So tell me about this pasta. Let me come on down. I'm going to give you some of these. You're going to show me how you want them. These are the cutest little zucchini I ever saw.
They're almost too cute to eat.
I know. But we're going to do it. I'm going to watch how you slice it, and I'm going to do the same.
Okay. So this is our zucchini pasta with our angel hair noodles in a garlic labneh sauce.
You know what's interesting? I have to say, I've eaten at Amanda's restaurant, and my meathead husband was wild about it.
I love that.
I thought we were going to have to go out for a steak afterwards, you know, but he just thought it was so great.
We try to use the vegetable in as many different ways as possible and bring out as many different textures.
I think you do some of the most creative cooking I've ever seen with vegetables.
Thank you.
But let's get these guys on.
Okay.
Olive oil or vegetable oil?
About 2 tablespoons.
Yeah.
And some salt. You do the salting.
That's
and then
good.
We've been heating up the grill. So can I just dump them
just
in?
Just dump them in.
Don't worry about laying them. I mean, I'll try to flatten them.
So this is called a spiralizer, and you can pretty much spiralize any hard vegetable. So I'm just gonna cut the ends off.
Okay.
And you're just gonna pop this straight in the middle here.
Okay.
And then this is gonna click on.
Oh, even I could do this.
And then they just start to come out.
So it comes out the other end.
Yeah, they are incredibly long. So it's like one giant piece.
Wow. Now, we're gonna use these as our pasta, right?
Yeah.
Along with the spaghetti. We're gonna actually add some cappellini, angel hair pasta.
Yeah.
Are we gonna cook that?
No, it's gonna cook down a little when we add it to the pasta.
We wanna get a little bit of grill marks on these, right?
A little, but they're almost there. They're gonna go pretty fast.
Okay. Let's get the sauce going. So I'm gonna get the, we need to mince some garlic, right?
Yep.
Should I start heating this burner up for our sauce?
Yeah.
Okay, and we're gonna get some oil in there in a minute. I do wanna get the rest of the zucchini out.
So the oil's pretty hot, I can see it. I'm just gonna add in garlic.
And then you're gonna add the saffron first.
Just a tiny pinch of it.
Okay. Now we are not using regular yogurt, we're using something that you call labneh.
Exactly. It's sort of a Middle Eastern style strained yogurt.
Okay, so labneh is different than Greek yogurt. You said Greek yogurt has additives.
It tends to have some additives in it. This is just pure milk that's been strained.
Okay, I think this is a better tool. It's about a cup and a half we're adding, I think.
Yeah,
You said this tends to split less.
Exactly. It'll stay together, whereas Greek yogurt, if you use it, you can. You just have to be much more gentle with it. It will split into two. Go ahead.
Do you want all of this water?
I think we're good
okay.
for the moment.
Mm-hmm. That's so interesting. Do you need salt?
Yes.
Okay. It's just garlic, saffron, labneh. And where do you buy it?
You can find it now at supermarkets, sort of the fancier supermarkets.
More water or good?
A little bit more water.
Okay. And then what do? Do we turn it off and then just quick heat it, or do we just let the heat of the pasta warm it?
We can turn it off as soon as this is stirred in.
Okay.
Oh. You can see it's like creamy, but it's not a cheese sauce.
Yeah.
It's nice. And it's going to have a little bit of a sour tang to it.
Yes. Yeah. So you know what? I think let's tidy up and check the lemonade.
Okay. Perfect.
Wow, that is so interesting. How it does get all sort of caramelized on top.
It's starting to get dark.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going to drop the pasta.
Exactly.
And we're using angel hair.
Yeah.
And I'm salting the water. How much do you think?
Just a small handful.
More than that?
No, I think that's perfect.
Really? Okay, so this is just sort of zucchini helper.
Exactly. It's
okay.
Just bulking it up a little.
You could do all zucchini noodles, though. Let me give it a stir.
You could. This makes it a little bit more like a meal if you have some real pasta in there.
You have something more substantial. Okay, so I'm giving it a stir. This only takes about 3 minutes.
Exactly.
And let's check the lemonade.
Okay.
Okay, so now we strain it.
Exactly.
Do you need help there?
No, I think I've got it.
Okay. I just don't know how you come up with these ideas. I really don't. To caramelize lemons with water in there is just so interesting.
Well, it's a lot easier than squeezing out all the juice, right?
Right. Okay, there we go. So now, yeah, you want to just pop that in here, and we'll make ourselves a cocktail.
It's cocktail
this
time.
This is your Kentucky bourbon lemonade cocktail.
Exactly.
Right.
So we're going to start with 2 ounces of bourbon in each one. 2 ounces, 3 ounces. It depends on what kind of day you've had, right?
Yeah, I was going to say what kind of mood you're in.
And after that, you can sort of eyeball the rest.
Eyeball. Now, as you add the beet juice, let's talk about it. So this is actually pink lemonade.
It is pink lemonade.
Because you've either roasted the beet and pureed it in one of those super mixers, or you just bought beet juice somewhere.
Exactly. That's what's really nice about the world today. There are juice shops
everywhere. Right.
Okay.
Then the lemon. That's beautiful already. Except that it's alcoholic. I'd say this would be a great drink for kids. It's so pretty.
We do make a virgin one without the alcohol
yeah.
at the restaurant.
And you don't tell them there's beets in there.
Exactly.
Right.
Soda water or mm-hmm. seltzer, mm-hmm. and then some lemon lime soda. It's just as good.
Well, I can't wait to try that. But we need to get our rest of our ingredients ready for the pasta.
Yeah.
So we need some zest. Do some mint, and I'm gonna
exactly.
do some lemons. I should have zested this first, but I was too enthusiastic and cut it right in half. And this is the garnish?
This is the garnish.
Wow, that mint smelled so good as soon as you just ripped it.
And you don't have to be finicky about how mm-hmm. you mince mm-hmm. it. I'm just gonna add a nice lively note to it.
Okay, so we need to juice this. We need a couple of tablespoons. Do you wanna juice this?
Yep.
And I'm gonna drain our pasta because I know it's gonna be done. And then I add that right to the zucchini noodles?
Yeah, exactly, and it's gonna help them cook
okay.
down.
Okay. Should I try to get it really dry?
Nope, a little bit of wet is good.
Okay, because it's also got the starch on it, which is gonna help, and now our sauce goes in.
Yeah.
I can't believe how that yogurt stayed together, because the general rule with the yogurt that most of us use is that it separates when it heats.
And it's the labneh is even more sour, so yeah. it's nice.
And then this goes in?
That goes in.
Well, this is so exciting. Oh, and we just toss it up. Wow, that already gets an A+ in visuals.
I know, right?
Okay. So let's bring down all our garnishes.
Okay.
And I just very gently get some of these big guys on top so they're accessible. All right, so how do we garnish?
Okay. So then we're just
this
gonna
This is so exciting. I have to say, I love your food.
The mint?
I really do.
Some lemon juice for acidity.
I mean, who knew there were so many layers to vegetables? We have some microgreens, and
there's gonna add a little bit of color,
oh,
and crunch.
All right. Well, I think we must go outside and dine outside.
I love it.
We need our cocktails. And wow, I can't wait to taste this.
Okay.
I feel like ladies who lunch, don't you?
Yes.
Do we ever lunch
afternoon.
As ladies? No.
We're too
right,
busy.
This guy's gonna stay in there. There we go. Okay.
Thank you.
No, we're too busy. This is so much fun. Just relaxing. It's hard to tell what's the zucchini and what's the noodle. All right, let's chow down.
Yeah.
Mmm. Wow. That yogurt sauce.
It's good, right?
Mmm. And the lemon. Fantastic.
The
thank you so much for coming today.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been amazing.
It's been so much fun. We get to lunch in the garden. I'm Sara Moulton here with Amanda Cohen. Thank you so much for joining us. I'll see you next time for more of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Okay, so wow,
cheers.
We didn't try this yet. We need to. Oh my God, that is so addictive.
Isn't it? It's very drinkable.
Oh, a little too drinkable.
Sara's Weeknight Meals continues online. For recipes, helpful tips, messages, and lots more, visit us on the web at saramoulton.com/weeknightmeals. And go to our YouTube channel, Sara's Weeknight Meals TV. Funding provided by
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester, with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
And thanks to the generous support of